children in Uganda. We're feeding children in India. We're sponsoring missionaries in India and in Cambodia. But more importantly, we're doing missions work right here at home. In just a couple weeks, I want to invite you right now. We're building Easter boxes, and now it's more important than ever. We're building boxes for families that may not have the necessities they need, and we want to provide them an Easter meal. And that box costs simply $25. That's all it is. But that's not a monetary value that we're putting on it. Anything you can sow today will help. But it's by your giving that we can do what we do at Lighthouse Nation, that we can truly leave our mark on the world. And for that, we give you great honor for the seeds that you sow. And as you're sowing, you can look at the screen. You can text to give. You can go to our website and hit the give icon. Or you can go to your church center app, text any amount, and you'll be emailed a receipt immediately. And as soon as it leaves your hands, God already begins to bless. We love you, and we want to pray over that right now as we transition. Father God, I give you the honor, the glory that only you deserve. You are our King of glory. You are greater than anything that may ever manifest against us. You're greater than any devil in hell that may come against us. We know that we are children of the one true King. And with you, we can do anything. I just ask that you take this tithe and this offering and you use it for the edification of your kingdom and the uplifting of your people. And if you agree with me this morning, right where you're at, I want you to say amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. It's okay. Go ahead and give him a hand clap of praise. I love you this morning. It's good to see you. Glad you're with us. I know this is a little unconventional. I don't know how many's on right now, but I just want to say I love you to each and every one of my Lighthouse family members. There are a few people in our building this morning to make all this happen, and my hat's off to them. I couldn't do anything I'm doing right now without them. But we're going to preach the word this morning. Is that okay?
Amen.
I can't hear you where you're at, so I need to feel you. Is that okay?
Amen.
All right, all right. I got something this morning that I want to call a special delivery. And it's going to be a special delivery. I'm going to throw some scripture references up for you. And in this time of fear and anxiety, I want to come bring you some good news. Is that okay?
Amen.
See, unquestionably right now, the most talked about subject everywhere, on social media, any news outlet, any article, it's all about the coronavirus, the COVID-19. Let's stop the spread. We got to stay 6 feet apart. We got to practice our social distancing. We've got to wash our hands. We got to cover our cough. Most of this is just common sense practice.
Amen.
But perhaps there's one thing that's more contagious than the virus, and that's fear. Fear has gripped the community. Fear has gripped the nation. Fear has gripped our world. Stock markets are dropping. Schools are closing. Some businesses have been forced to shut down. We've been encouraged to almost quarantine ourselves and work at home if possible. Let's limit our meeting to no more than 10. And just that quick, the devil has emptied a church building. But little did he know. By emptying the church building, Pastor Jonathan, he just turned us loose on the world.
Amen.
See, he's forced us into situations now that may make us uncomfortable. But it's all in God's plan. See, what's happening right now didn't surprise God. It didn't jump up on him. It didn't reach out and scare him. He didn't have to have a planning meeting. He knew exactly what was happening. And yes, we have travel limits. We have other limitations. We have to acknowledge our elderly and our ones that have weaker immune systems. But in addition to health, we also have to recognize those that are unable to work and that may be facing financial challenges. But 2 Timothy verse 1:7 says, "For God gave us a spirit of not fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind." Some translations said he did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and self-control. In other words, 75 cases of toilet paper ain't gonna make you feel any safer. 15 cases of oodles and noodles ain't gonna make it go away. But you gotta understand, fear is contagious. And it doesn't take much for fear to spread uncontrollably. But I want you to understand something this morning. You're a carrier. You're carrying something this morning that not everybody can carry. See, you're carrying something very special. See, when people get near you, they should feel something different. They should see something different. See, when they get near you, they should understand you got something. See, Paul writes it this way in 1 Thessalonians. He said, "We always thank God for all of you and continually to mention you in our prayers. For we remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired our hope in the Lord Jesus Christ." I'm looking for some folks that understand what work. See, the church long forgot what work is. We're just happy because God saved us. But it says here that it was your faithful work, your loving deeds, and your enduring hope. So why do we have faith, hope, and love? It's because of Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 1:5 says, "Because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction." See, what Paul's saying is, we brought you good news. Imagine when there's a treatment for the COVID-19. Imagine a cure or even a way to prevent it. How long do you think it will take for that news to spread? But I want to tell you about a good news this morning that doesn't just heal physical sickness. It cures spiritual sickness. See, Jesus didn't come for the healthy, y'all. He came for the sick. He didn't come for the righteous. He came for the sinners. Our God just didn't shout his love from heaven. He sent his son to show up on earth. I hope you're clapping where you at, because I'm preaching where I'm at, and I feel it this morning. See, we're saved by grace through our faith. Our faith is what makes us strong. That's good news worth spreading. So the question is, are you a carrier of that good news this morning? Are you contagious this morning? Is what you have worth spreading? 1 Thessalonians 1:8 says, "For not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia and Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we not need say nothing." I believe there's a time coming when just the fact of walking in the room will change an atmosphere. That you can preach the word without using words. That just a demonstration of the Holy Spirit shows up when you show up. It makes that song, "When you walk into the room, everything changes." Because if you understand that the steps of a righteous man are ordered, he entered the room long before you did. He entered this situation long before we did. He's seen a virus and made a cure before we ever heard of the word virus. Yeah. See, it's ringing out. It should be echoing everywhere. It should be spreading from you to cover people everywhere in this community. See, that's what happens when people catch a passion for Jesus. What they have starts to spread. We no longer want to hide it like a city on a hill with a lampstand. We don't hide it under a basket. We want the world to see what we're about. See, news needs to start to spread. We need to understand that what we're carrying is stronger than anything that is out there to stop us. See, when Jesus raised a little girl from the dead in Matthew 9:26, news of this spread throughout that region. When Jesus cast out evil spirits in Mark 1:28, news about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. When God used his disciples to do miracles, in Acts 6:7, it says, "So the word of God spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly." I'm looking at a time right now that the word of God spread faster than the COVID-19. Faster than any virus can move and can change lives. I believe God in an instant can take it and change and radically change people's outlook and their life. So why did this good news, why did the message, why did the word of God spread so quickly? It was because of people's faithful work, their loving deeds toward others, and their enduring hope. See, faith is believing that something's going to happen. Hope is the activator. See, when I plant seeds in a garden, I have faith that it's going to come up. But my hope is what activates it. See, I don't just sit back and hope with fear. See, you can use hope in two different ways. I hope this goes away. I hope we find a cure. I hope church gets to come back together. I put my hope in the one that hung the stars. And there's no doubt when I open my eyes and look up at night that they're going to shine. Because my hope is not in what I know physically, it's what I know spiritually. So my hope activates my faith. Ooh, I wish, if I could reach out and slap somebody, I would. See, fear is contagious, but so is faith. I don't know about you, but I'm proud to say I'm a carrier this morning. I'm a faith spreader. I like to spread faith. I like to give love. And I'm a hope dealer. Y'all didn't know I was dealing, did you? I'm dealing hope this morning. If you get too close to me, you better be careful. You might catch what I'm carrying. Because of the Lord Jesus, I'm full of faith and not fear this morning. And some people say, "Pastor, why aren't you afraid that Christians aren't being able to gather in church buildings?" Because I've told you since day one, the church needs to leave the building. Elvis ain't the only one that left the building, y'all. It's time for the church to get outside of the four walls. It's time for the church to roll up in communities. It's time for the church to quit worrying about cute little padded chairs and pews and cool little music. It's time for the church to do what God mandated us to do, and that's spread the good news of the gospel. We don't go to church. We are the church. Look at somebody in your living room, say he's talking to you. Jesus didn't say go into your homes and hide and rest. Jesus didn't say to quarantine yourself. Dr. J. Pike, who I look up to tremendously, wonderful, wonderful young man, posted something the other day about the word quarantine was an Italian word that meant 40 days. Let that sit. Because what would happen is when ships would come in, if they had any sick passengers, they would quarantine them for 40 days until they could get well. What if? What if the church is actually the boat this morning? And we've been sick. We've been sick with our own doctrine and our own theologies and our own. We've just been messed up. We've been catching stuff, but it's called drama from other people. It's called mediocrity. It's called not a spirit of excellence. And God has taken our boat and quarantined us till he can release us healthy and whole on a community that's starving for us. He didn't tell us to stay home. He said, go into the world and shine. If we can't get together physically today, we're going to get together digitally. Thank God for technology. Brother Paul had to walk. All we had to do was log on this morning. You can be sitting there in your PJs with your favorite cup of coffee, eating a cookie, hitting a little Shandai every now and then. It's okay. It's biblical to eat, break bread. See, the good news is worth spreading. All over the world this morning, there's digital evangelists everywhere, and I love it. For once, churches are not arguing anymore. Woo, ain't it just like God? To take away everything you know and your comfort zones and say, I want to. We love to say, well, God just don't understand how I'm thinking right now. Yes, he does. He knew you were going to run to Walmart and get 27 cases of water. But that don't make you a disciple. He knew you were going to huddle up for safety, scared to death to touch anybody. He knows we're his disciples by the way we love one another. By the way we build boxes for our communities. By the way we go above and beyond to help those that are in need that can't help themselves sometimes. See, in John 13:35, it says, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. You know, this virus is serious. It's not to be taken lightly. But I have noticed nobody is arguing about race anymore. They're not arguing about the national deficit. They're not arguing about sports. They're not arguing about finances. Most of them quit even arguing about the present. But it seems like everybody's on one page. What do we do to keep each other safe? Well, I know a doctor this morning. See, we need to understand, how can we meet our needs of the community? How can we meet those that truly need us? What if we can help tutor kids that are out of school? What if we can run errands for those that are in compromised situations? What if we can partner with local missions or other churches? What if we could offer child care for health care workers whose daycares may be closed? See, that's what it's like to be able to spread faith, to offer love, and to deal hope. See, we've got hope that no virus can kill. Yeah, we hope things go back to normal, but I want it way more than that. I've never been classified as being normal anyway. See, normal's comfortable. Normal's selfish. Normal's spiritually safe and spiritually lukewarm. And I believe we know what the scripture says about being lukewarm for God. I'm believing with all my heart that this is a wake-up call for the churches to unite, to stand together, to stand strong, to stand boldly. It's time for the church to shine God's light. Amen. Now, you're going to have to forgive me if I get a little animated in this, but once I get going, it's like a speaker on the inside of me wanting to erupt, and I can't run a lap this morning, but I am in my spirit. See, I support all of our government leaders, but my hope is not in government. I pray for all of our medical workers and our healthcare providers, but my hope is not in the doctors. See, I'm even praying for all the spiritual leaders around the world, but my hope is not even in them. My hope is in the one who spoke the world into existence. My hope is in the all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present God.
My hope is in the one who heals deaf ears, opens blind eyes, and raises the dead. See, I believe in faith, hope, and love this morning because of Jesus. Who is Jesus? He's a door which we enter, a spiritual bread that strengthens our soul. He delivers the captives and restores the broken. He strengthens the weak. He's my provider, my comforter, my source, my strength, and my redeemer. He's my rock, my sustainer, my assurance, and my firm foundation. I wish I had some help. He's my shelter in my time of trouble, my light when the world goes dark. He is the Prince of Peace, the Lily of the Valley, the Lamb of God, the Alpha, the Omega, the Resurrection, the Truth, and the Life. And I wish you would just reach out to Him this morning. See, His goodness is indescribable. His power is incomprehensible. His grace is irresistible. At His very name, Delton, this will hit you, son. Darkness trembles. In His presence, demons flee. Death couldn't defeat Him. The grave couldn't stop Him. And hell couldn't hold Him. Woo! Fear may be contagious, but so is faith this morning. Hate is contagious, but so is love. Worry and doubt is contagious, but so is hope. And it's all because of faith, hope, and love. Are you spreading faith today? Or are you spreading fear? Are you showing love? Are you offering hope? See, I want to know if I'm speaking to people carrying something this morning. And more importantly, is what you're carrying worth spreading? It's great news. It's awesome news. And as the world grows darker, I want our light to shine brighter. Brighter than it's ever shone before. Because my faith's not in man this morning. I'm praying for this world, but I understand who I'm praying to. I'm not praying with an if. I'm praying with a yes and amen. I want you to bow your heads right where you are this morning. Father, I love You. I just wish I could reach my arms out and hug every man, woman, and child that's watching right now. And I want to offer you something this morning from heaven. That's hope. Hope not for a cure, because the cure is already there. I want to offer you hope this morning that this world turns to God. I want to demonstrate it through faith, Father. I want to boldly be able to share Your good news to anyone. And Father, no matter where they are this morning, I want You to love on them. Let us show love in this time of uncertainty. Let us be the dealers of the gospel. Father, we have every resource at our fingertips, and yet we've put You in a box. Well, it's time to tear the top off that box. Father, I release the Holy Spirit right now into our community, into our state, and into this nation. Father, I ask that You walk freely into households all throughout this world and give them a peace that transcends all understanding. Give them a comfort that everything is okay. Because if You hung the very stars in the sky, and I send faith, hope, and love to their doorstep this morning. And if there's one out there that don't know You, Father, I ask that they open up their heart right now.
It's as simple as this. You can repeat after me. Father, forgive me. Forgive me of my sins, Father. Father, I believe that you died for me, that you were buried in a borrowed tomb, and on the third day you were raised from the dead, and that my sins are covered. And if you said that prayer this morning, you're just as safe as the man with a microphone, because he said your sins are covered. No weapon in hell